Hi, I'm Jen Farley, and I believe that there's a rock star within all of us. So I am going out and talking to people who I believe are rock stars in what they do. It has been a while since I have talked to anybody and recorded one of these. So today I'm so excited to talk to my friend, Kate Bast. Kate is a forest bathing guide, certified forest bathing guide.
Yep.
And the owner of Shinrin-Yoku Madison, which is a forest bathing and nature-based company, isn't it?
It is. Guiding people into the woods to find some calmness, maybe a balm, some healing, and stillness, which has been, especially these past 2 years, has been just a really difficult place to find. It's just that present moment beingness, and nature is, it's built to help us find that.
Ulterior motives, because Kate and I are collaborating on some special retreats called True Nature, True Self Retreats for the year 2022. Mm-hmm. So we will get to all of that, but welcome, Kate.
Thank you, Jen. This is so fun. I love it.
I know, it's just like us, like hanging out and chilling.
Yeah, exactly.
In my sunroom.
So with all these awesome views of nature.
Yeah.
I might not leave today, Jen.
Oh, that's totally fine. This room is called Hotel California because you could check in anytime you'd like, but you can never leave.
Never leave.
Never.
I don't want to leave.
Nope. And you'll usually see some pretty crazy things out there with the nature. Excellent. And the birds and stuff. Anyways, Kate, tell me about how you got started with forest bathing.
Yeah, I was actually editor-in-chief of BRAVA Magazine, and for anybody local to Madison, Wisconsin, it's a women's empowerment magazine located here. And I was, you know, doing some research, and, you know, my publisher is a good friend and also a nature girl, and we were just talking about story ideas, and she said, oh, I found this idea. I read about it in the Washington Post. Does anybody here do this? So I did some research, and it was called Shinrin-Yoku. And so I looked it up. I'm like, no, there's nobody here doing anything like that. And I went to the association website and read it. And after that, I emailed my husband and my closest friend and said, hey, in my next life, I am going to be a forest bathing guide. And they're like, okay, that's... whatever, Kate. Sounds a little odd, but okay, you do you. And I was just really enamored with it. And instead, we did a story on nature deficit disorder, which kind of just drove it home for me. And it's all about our disconnection and separation from nature and the negative impacts that has upon us. I mean, think of these days in our modern homes, in our modern office buildings, they're airtight, great ventilation systems, but still airtight. Some of us sit in, you know, cube land, may not have natural light,
right,
which is really an awful place to dwell for
right
8 hours in a day, not right having the natural light, and the opportunity to see the clouds and the sky and birds flitting by in nature. And, you know, it is the root cause of a lot of problems, and being in nature can also solve a lot of those problems or help remedy them, soften them. Things like stress, anxiety, PTSD, ADHD, there's studies. There's also some exciting studies going on about how nature can impact breast cancer in women and childhood cancer. So there's a lot of really great things happening in nature. So anyhow, after researching all of this and learning about all of this, I also realized, like, wait a minute, I am going to nature more and more and more to deal with my own stress and anxiety. And this would be going to the dog park for an hour, and then I call my family and say, nope, it's going to be another hour. And then I'd say, nope, Cleo and I, my dog, we're going to be here another hour, until we would get to this spot where it was just like a break. And I suddenly just, like, I could breathe more deeply and relax. And what was I doing? Well, we were walking around. I was sitting under oak trees, closing my eyes and just listening to the leaves rustle, watching those russet grasses in mm-hmm. autumn, just watching how the wind would course through them and noticing the various patterns. And I think I've told you, patterns in nature, especially these repeating patterns, the fractal patterns, if you look at those for just even 5 minutes, and this is based on a study out of Oregon, it can decrease your stress by 60%. For five minutes. Yeah. So think about when you're living in Cube Land, and if you're there 8 hours a day and probably not taking a lunch break like so many of us do, and probably coming in early and staying late, you're not getting access to that. I mean, just 5 minutes of looking at patterns, natural patterns. Now, you can have a plant at your desk. You can, you know, watch nature on your video screen, but I like to be outside in the real deal. So realizing all these things and realizing like, hey, this is actually what I'm doing in my own life to manage my stress and anxiety, and I can actually help other people learn how to do this. I was just totally sold and decided that my next life started the next year. And so I left my publishing career to train and launch a business in this. And it's been super healing for me and friends and people in my family. And it's just been really amazing to see with this idea of nature deficit disorder, guiding people in the woods when they say, I've never been in nature like this. Like, I hike through all the time. I go fast. I'm with my friends.
Yeah. Right? So you really, like, left the corporate world to help people and guide people to find themselves in nature or just connect with nature.
Exactly. Yeah, and I kind of, like, you know, we've talked about when we've been out there, some people call it mindfulness in the woods. Yeah, it's that, but I like to call it mindlessness because we're really putting the rational mind to rest and we're tapping into the senses and the felt experience. So we are being through our senses. And when we do that, our senses exist only in the present moment. Right? So you are naturally in the present and this just kind of turns off or it spins off and goes somewhere else in the woods. Mm-hmm. And I just find it, whatever I was all hot and bothered about when I first went to the woods, I can't even tell you what that was when I crossed the threshold back out. So it's really great for workplaces, anybody, really anybody who's dealing with a lot of stress or just needs a break.
So
it's very interesting to take that ability to be present and just notice what's coming to you, what's bubbling up, and pairing that with your skill of life coaching and helping people go from that place to even deeper places within themselves.
Yeah. I think it's really interesting, too, though, that you mentioned that, like, people are like, oh, I hike through the woods all the time. But it's that intention and taking a moment to actually be present.
Right.
Because, mm-hmm. like, we're all living our lives, right? We're all doing all the things.
Right.
But when we take a moment to be present is when we truly can feel some peace.
Exactly. Yeah. And it's the place where we finally have space, things bubble up, and we are able to notice whether it's some hearing or vision or just something that you're sensing in your body. I mean, we're so busy, rarely do we have time for things to bubble up. And when we create that opening, other things bubble up as well, right?
Right.
We can become introspective. We have noticings about ourselves. We have moments of awe. We're steeped in beauty. And that's what's so amazing about pairing life coaching and the questions and the way you pose your questions to people to help them tap into those things and draw them to the fore.
Yeah. So let's talk about that. Let's talk about our retreat.
Our fun thing.
Our collaborations. So often in coaching, when I'm working with a client, metaphors come up a lot.
Right.
Like, oh, I'm stirring the pot or my glass is empty or things like that. But then actually being in the experience of nature and connecting those metaphors to what someone might be feeling is really powerful.
It is. Yeah. It really is. And that's an amazing thing that in my experience, and I know yours, because we've done a little bit of this as an experiment in the past year, people come to find things about themselves. They may say that they didn't know, but it's often that they just didn't listen to or something they kept pushing down for whatever reason. And so then there's a lot about intuition that comes into play too.
Yeah.
It's like listening, trusting your gut, listening to your intuition. And, you know, I think I told you this story about being on a walk and there was a whole group with us, and they're like, oh yeah, I go to nature all the time. I run 5K every day through the preserve. And one woman said, oh yeah, I walk through there every single day, but I do my power walking. And as we are together on the trail, it was in spring, and there are these little tiny frogs. Just all of a sudden I noticed they're just covering the trail. So I stopped and started silently pointing them out to people. And it took some people a while because they did look like stones, and you had to be looking in the right spot for it to move, right? But that's noticing. And once you notice, you start to notice more and more. So then you're seeing all these little frogs. And when we came together and just shared our noticings, she said, I realized, like, oh my gosh, I'm stepping on all the tiny frogs in my life, and I just don't even know it. And that was just, she's like, I think that means I need to slow down, and I'm doing too much, and I'm not focusing on these little things that I keep putting off and putting off and putting off. And she was super emotional, but it was beautiful, and the group held space for her, and it was a huge opening for her.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I love that metaphor of I'm stepping on all the tiny frogs in my life.
Right.
Because she wasn't slowing down.
Exactly.
And giving herself space. Yeah,
exactly. And she was very much tending to other people and their needs and not giving herself time to focus on the little things in her own life. Yeah. Another great one is if you think of a stick, and this is often an invitation. So when we're forest bathing, offer invitations or just prompts, ways to connect with nature in the very moment. A stick. Just peel the bark and peel the bark until you notice or find what's underneath.
Mm.
Right? I'm not telling you what to find. For you, it might be like, oh, the bark is so smooth. But for other people, it's like this uncovering, you know, peeling, peeling, peeling layers. And then it's just fascinating to see what it is that everyone finds.
And it's all different.
Different for everybody. It depends where you're at and how much you're allowing yourself to open, connect to nature, and really drop into that space. But it's always different. And that's the fascinating thing for life coaching too, right? Every client you work with is different.
Absolutely.
Every noticing is different. Every awareness, every aha moment. But when we're doing these two things together and as a group, we are all learning from everybody else's experience. Yeah. And as they're embodying their experience by like speaking it out loud, we get to incorporate that into our own experiences and notice maybe there's an opening in what this person learned or what was revealed for them for ourselves.
Yeah.
So,
well, very similar in terms of like with coaching is that I might ask a question, but I don't have a set answer. The answer is within that person to find and discover and to peel back their layers to
find
what their core is.
Exactly. So. What is that? There's a style. It's in
powerful questions.
Yes. Yeah. Questions. And I love that's what
they're open-ended. Yeah.
Open-ended questions, which you're not telling them what to find, and it's all what comes to them.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, so they can, it's more powerful, right? When people find these things than if we were telling them you need to do this, you need to do that.
Right.
That's not the path to find healing or a deeper sense of yourself.
No. Well, because just like with anything, like if you do something for someone, they're going to rely on you to do it. You're the cure. But when they're the ones that find that discovery, they see that they have it within themselves.
Exactly. And that whole tapping into intuition and like trusting yourselves. And I think so many of us ignore that because we get stuck in this rational mind logic when often if we can get to the core of those, and maybe that's got to be what you find in life coaching.
Yeah.
Like once people get to that core acknowledgement or realization of what is at the core and at the base and acknowledge it and believe it as true and real for themselves, that's like the path.
Yeah, absolutely.
To major openings.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's super, I don't know, this is super fun to do.
Yeah.
We have just had a blast together.
Well, I mean, it does help that we, you know, like to spend time with each other, and we're kind of goofy.
Yeah.
Very similar.
And we're being
personality.
Like semi-serious right now.
We're being very serious.
We like to laugh. We cry.
Yeah.
We
swear.
We do. Yeah. We do it all. It's just,
Thanks, hon.
Sorry.
Yeah.
You're on tape.
Yeah.
Too funny. Too funny. Yeah, and I just find that the sort of test runs that we've done is, it becomes a very joyful walk in the woods, mm-hmm. and it's a chance for people to also process emotions, and like with the life coaching questions too, getting past limiting beliefs.
Yep.
And
yeah.
Yeah, like what else are you helping people tap into with life coaching around or related to the forest bathing?
Well, and like I had said earlier about the metaphors, like looking at a tree and like the different changes of the seasons, mm-hmm. and how like a person can also change in the seasons. And like in the fall when the trees are releasing their leaves, like what do you need to release? Mm-hmm. What do you need to release in order to grow?
Right.
Or what do you need to leave here and in order for you to expand?
Right.
It's really like taking those hints from nature, mm-hmm. and asking what that person might need.
Exactly.
At the time.
Yeah, that's beautiful. And I love that we're doing this together in nature, because then that also becomes a place for people to either, you know, if you're having a moment in your day, mm-hmm. like close your eyes, think back to perhaps that invitation or where you were in the woods. And then bring yourself back to that place, and you will find that you're going back to that sense of calm.
Oh my gosh, yes.
You know?
There's the opening meditation where we sit for like 20 minutes in the woods, and we like literally are sitting on the floor. I always go back to that smell of pine, mm-hmm. because we're sitting amongst pine needles. And I often think about that, like how calming and relaxing that is.
Yeah.
So it gives you like little anchors.
Right.
Too, to exactly. take along with you.
Exactly. Plus, breathing in the pine air has health benefits too. It increases our immune function actually by 40%. So yeah, so hence the research on cancer and mm-hmm. cancers. And yeah, there's all kinds of other great things that happen by sitting in a grove of pines, which we'll share with you. We'll share the many benefits when we are in the woods, if you would like to join us.
So yeah. How often are people are like forest bathing? Do you have to get naked?
No. You could if you wanted, but we're not doing that. I'm not going
to subject that to anyone.
Yes, exactly. It's also not naked tree climbing, which one of my nephews is positive that's really what I'm doing with people.
I remember, though, one of the best descriptions about forest bathing is similar to sunbathing, when mm-hmm. you are sitting out and you're letting the sun just penetrate your whole mm-hmm. being. And that's kind of what forest bathing is.
Yeah, just letting nature wash over you. So you're like just steeping yourself in the atmosphere of nature. It can be the sun, it can be the wind, the bird song, the smell of different flowers, the earth, you know,
yeah.
how clay feels, how sand feels, the different bark textures. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's just letting it wash over and just fill you to relieve you of all that stuff that bops around in your head or in your bodies. I mean, it physically relaxes you too.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's one of the values of doing these things together, is that there is so much relaxation and release just from being in nature, that, you know, we kind of let go of those tight muscles and other things that we hold so tightly,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
to be able to create that opening to do some deeper exploration.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the first one that we're doing is March 6th.
Mm-hmm.
And we are using private land, which is awesome. We have some friends that have some land. So it's not like we're going to find someone else that's hiking through the woods.
Right. Yeah, which is perfect, because you don't know what's going to bubble up. It can
right.
be joy. It could be simply that, my gosh, the sky is so blue. I never slow down enough to just pause and notice it.
Mm-hmm.
I never notice how the light filters through the leaves. And boy, that's just gentle. And it makes me feel this way or that way. Sometimes it's grief that mm-hmm. bubbles up.
Yeah.
And, you know, nature doesn't judge. We don't judge. We hold space for that. So does nature. So does the whole group. And so if you are coming, there's no reason to feel inhibited by any mm-hmm. of what's coming up for you. There's not going to be anybody there that you have to worry about running into and explaining yourself.
Right.
You know, we're with a group of like-minded people, and the private land lets us do the processing and exploring we each
yeah.
need.
Yeah. And it's very important for us to create a safe an intimate space.
Absolutely. So. Absolutely. Yeah. Especially when people are exploring the sensitive things that are going to come through their life coaching questions and musings and what that's going to lead them to.
Yeah. Yeah.
I know. It'll be so great. We also have this land of many, many acres to explore, from a pond and with giant trees around it to an open kind of prairie-like setting through the woods, through the pine trees. Mm-hmm. There's a marsh. There's a creek. So we have a lot of different landscapes to work with.
Yeah.
And each walk will be different. We're, you know, a whole different set of themes.
Yes.
For each one, one will be creativity and play.
And yes. And that's true. Like, I found too, like, there are moments going on walks with you where I am, like, feeling like a kid again, like, because I've released all of these feelings that have been holding me down as an adult, but, like, to be able to be uninhibited and to play,
right.
and to play in the woods, like.
Exactly. We might build forts. We could build forts. Yeah. I mean, climb trees, who knows? But yeah, that sense of letting go is so important, to let those things bubble up and just finding joy. I mean, we have a rule for that one. It's no adulting.
No adulting.
No adulting. We adults 24/7. And this is just a time to reconnect with that inner child. And our inner child has a lot of wisdom probably and enlightenment for us.
Yes. When your inner child shows up, it's trying to tell you something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What else should we tell them?
The first one's on connection. The second one is
creativity and play.
Creativity. Inner knowing, is that?
I think that's the third one. Like, working on listening. Now that you've let go and done something creative, learning how to listen to yourself and trust your intuition and your gut. And lean on those, you know, especially when we're digging into ourselves, you know yourself better than anyone else.
Yeah.
And we're learning how to listen to ourselves more fully.
Yeah.
And then the fourth one.
Is how to carry it forward. Yes.
Yeah, so.
How to be able to do this without us being there. So these are all four different retreats that can build off of each other or can be taken one at a time. So we have special pricing for people that want to do all four. We have VIP pricing for people that want to do all four, plus get a couple of extras like one-on-one coaching with me and a walk with Kate. Or we have the opportunity to just do drop-ins for dates that might be available to you.
So. Yeah, and each one is 3 hours long.
Yes.
And we follow a structure, the forest bathing. If you're a certified guide through a certain organization, you follow a certain structure.
Mm-hmm.
So we start with them, cross a threshold and start with our meditation. And then we're really attuned to what's going on in nature in the present moment for the forest bathing invitations and what that opens for how Jen wants to help you explore yourself. And sometimes it's 3 invitations. Sometimes it's 6. It depends on, you know, where everyone's headed.
Yeah, and sometimes it's different between people that are there.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. And we do have, you know, we'll have some refreshment and snack for you, so don't worry about that. And it's just really being prepared for the weather. There's no bad weather.
Just bad clothes.
Exactly. And then it's just about coming out and being. And I mean, think of the beauty of, you know, people sometimes say to me, like, well, why do I need to go to the woods with you? I can go to the woods by myself. But it's a particular way of going to nature that allows these openings. And don't you think it's the same thing, like working with a coach? I mean, I have a much better experience if I do yoga with someone who knows what they're doing rather than me.
Yeah, absolutely. But it's also about, like, having that person, like, stop and have you reflect and look at things that you might not notice. I saw, a meme the other day saying, like, I don't want to hike with someone that wants to get to the top where they're going as fast as they can. I want to hike with, like, 12-year-olds that want to play and, like, elderly people who are going slow because, that slows you down.
Yeah. So, well, and the journey is where all the fast, gets you to a place, but focusing on the journey is really important. and what's revealed along the way.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anything else you want to know about
the forest? I'm also really excited about the fact that we're doing these in different seasons of the year and we're visiting the same mm-hmm. land. So I'm really excited to see how the land and the trees and the nature around it changes each time we come back. So we start in March mm-hmm. and there will be snow on the ground because we live in Wisconsin.
Yes.
And then the next one is May, I want to say.
Yep, May. June, we're skipping the mosquito month of July, right? And then September, October.
Yep.
So, yeah, that's going to be interesting to see what the seasons layers in for everybody.
Yeah.
And what they find. Yeah. Anything more? Well, I don't know if we explained, like, the way this will work. It's the forest bathing prompt, and those might be 5 minutes long. They might be 20. Mm-hmm. They might be 30. It just depends on what's going on with nature, and we're also intuitive. We're reading what's going on with the group mm-hmm. and noticing where people seem to really be dropping in or to want to drop in. And then we come together and share, and Jen leads us through some more life coaching prompts, and then we share again mm-hmm. each time. It's almost like peeling an onion each time, right?
Yeah.
Like layer, layer, layer. And and we end with some contemplative time with nature.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and tea. Kate makes the best tea.
Yes. Part of forest bathing. Through my group, we always serve a tea. Often it's foraged from the land or representative of what grows on the land or in our region of Wisconsin. And that's also about when we're making things from the land, we are also, it's another way of incorporating the medicine of the forest on so many levels, sort of this personal healing we're talking about, the actual health and medicinal benefits. But we're also drinking in that experience. Drinking it in to carry it away with ourselves and incorporate it. And it's just sort of a ritual of acknowledging that you came, you did, you opened.
Yeah.
You learned.
It's also just getting back in touch with what's around us.
Yeah. Right. Something really essential
about
it.
And so simple.
So simple. Yeah, I feel like so many of us just complicate
mm-hmm.
our lives or our paths. We're like, wait, I should do this, and I should do that, but I should do this first, and blah, 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 blah.
Right.
And then it just never gets done
nope.
because there's too much distraction.
Yeah.
Or too much setup rather than just jumping in and getting to the heart of the matter, which I think happens really quickly by carrying these two practices together. Mm-hmm.
So in your experience, as you have gone through this journey yourself mm-hmm. as a becoming a forest bathing facilitator, mm-hmm. What kind of advice were you given that you still hold on to?
The advice really, there's so much. Where do I start?
I know, right?
Yeah, but the idea of going slowly and silently, there is no cardio. Like, we're not hiking. We're not getting to some place specific on top of a mountain. We are getting someplace else, right? But just the going slowly enough to notice. And Mary Oliver, who happens to be the poet laureate of the ANFT, which is the association I'm affiliated with, wrote, once you notice, you begin to notice more and more, right? And that's metaphorical, translational to ourselves mm-hmm. too. Like, once you learn how to start noticing and listening, there's so much more that comes to you. And the idea of stillness, like I'm known to go on walks and lay down under a tree with my feet up the tree, and then people come along the trail and I'm like, I'm okay. But they're curious, like, what are you doing? And just giving yourself permission to do those kinds of things, let go of that inhibition and just be and notice. And it's important when you're going, you know, I have a sit spot in nature that I go to, and I sit at least 20 minutes as longer when I have the luxury. And it's amazing what new things come to you every time. And when you sit for 20 minutes, the birds come back. The squirrels become curious, right?
I think one time deer actually showed up while we were...
Yes, on one of our forest bathing life coaching walks. It was amazing. Yeah, so things start coming back to you, and then because there's more coming and you're deepening your senses, you're able to notice more and more and more. And just really another thing I took away is staying open to this idea of interconnectedness. I mean, we're made from the same stuff of nature, mm-hmm. right? It feels like home to some people. It doesn't feel like home to everyone. It has not been a safe space throughout history. But just pausing to notice, oh, here the squirrel is back. And, oh, I wonder what kind of squirrel that is. I'm going to look it up. Oh, and that squirrel is here because there's a big oak tree and they like oaks or a hickory or whatever. And just noticing who or what else is there. And it helps you in your own life realize what your own connections are, where you've sent out your roots, where you want your arbor to grow and reach out to. But it also kind of helps you reconnect with yourself and your sense of place of the land, but also your sense of place in the world and your purpose. Mm-hmm. So it's really, really trusting that nature has your back and has a lot to share with you and open you up to, really. And just going in with that open mindset is everything. Mm-hmm. No expectation.
Yeah, I love that.
And it's interesting, too, because with my band, mm-hmm. I think I told you this, one of our experiences in forest bathing and taking a hike through nature inspired a song that we are currently working on. So nature also like just sprung some creativity, and I had these lyrics come to me, and a lot of it is being about letting go of expectations,
right,
and just dancing in the field.
Yeah.
So I'm really excited to share that when it's ready.
Oh my gosh, I can't wait. Yeah. Wow. I will say I do tend to always listen to Al Green and Barry White music when I'm like feeling happy and want to jam that some more.
So besides our amazing retreats, what other activities do you have going on with Shinrin-Yoku? Because mm-hmm. I was saying Rin
before.
Well,
it's good that you said Rin because that helps people spell it.
Yes.
Because it is spelled with an R but pronounced as a D.
Okay.
Yeah.
Shinrin-Yoku.
So thank you.
Yes.
Yeah. What else do I have going on? Mm-hmm. I am doing some really cool field trips for the Natural Resources Foundation this year. One is pairing forest bathing with foraging. It's that same idea of what we're doing together is learning how to notice, learning how to really see and find, and then using that skill to be able to find things in nature. Mm-hmm. And I'm going to do two of those. And then there is also, with my friend Beth, this creativity series. So it's called The Art of Nature.
Oh,
and it's part forest bathing and part artistic creation. You do not have to be an artist, right? It's just this idea of how much nature amplifies our creativity and letting ourselves really lean into that and enjoy the process. And we'll come away with things you can bring home, but there's, you know, this is not for Picasso only, you know? I'm not an artist, but I sure love going out there and just finding natural materials and making something from them. So there's going to be some of that. And then I'm also working on some other retreats with another friend. She does aromatherapy and yoga. And then we're going to do some creative art projects as well and do some forest bathing and some other things. I'll do some more of my full moon walks. When the timing is right. Like if the moon's rising at 2 a.m., no, I'm not. We won't be in the woods then. But, you know, the solstices and the equinoxes, those are really interesting, powerful times. So mm-hmm. we'll do some walks around then. And also, I have to say one of my favorite walk series is the sunset and fireflies. So if I can time it right, sunset, fireflies, moonrise, all in a night.
Oh,
and sometimes full moon. And it is just pure magic going in the dark. So
that's amazing.
And there'll be more, but that's what I've got. It's what I'm putting on the docket for now.
Yeah. And you can find, they could find your schedule at shinrin-yoku madison.com.
Yeah. And you can get both. If you go to truenaturetrueself.com, which Jen like created, it seemed like in like 5 minutes, which is amazing. It's great site. She also put information on both of our backgrounds and where and how to read more about us or more about what life coaching is or mm-hmm. forest bathing. So you can reach out to us that way too.
And then how to get more information yeah. about the actual yeah. retreats that we're doing.
Yeah. Well, one thing I'm curious about, and I don't know if everybody asks you this, but how did you come to life coaching? I mean, it's fabulous musical career and all this talent mm-hmm. and like one of the most organized people I know ever. Yeah, amazing. And those, like, what was it for you?
So some of the music that we were creating in the band that I'm in was very much connected with a lot of life coaching concepts. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to dive deeper. Honestly, it like sparked my curiosity.
Yeah.
It sparked my curiosity. And I knew about life coaching, but I didn't really know. Mm-hmm. I had been coached before, but I didn't really know.
Right.
And those moments that I had been coached were very powerful.
Right.
So it was an opportunity to really learn how to listen, learn how to ask questions, learn how to get curious.
Right.
With somebody versus me saying, I think you should do this.
Right.
This is what you should do.
So I've solved it for you.
Yes. So really, like, music, the music that I was doing had led me to look into it even more. Mm-hmm. And I was also working with college students at the time and seeing them working on projects, but then, like, not necessarily acknowledging that there's a whole person behind the one project mm-hmm. that they're doing. So mm-hmm. like how you might go to work during the day, but you have a really bad night at home, that influences how you show up.
Right.
So really seeing, learning about the whole person.
Yeah.
So that's kind of, that was cool. My journey.
That's so cool. And with the college students too, like I wish I had learned all of these skills when I was that age or in high school. You know, who knows what choices I would have made?
I know, but I also think that, like, we learn it at the time that we're supposed to learn
it.
That's
true, when we can open to it and really grow.
Because if someone told me some of the things that are really important to me now about, you know, life, I'd be like, yeah, okay, thanks.
Did you talk to my mom?
Exactly.
Did my mom tell you to say that? you're right. You're right. And it's just, both have been so valuable. To me in my life. And I will say, like, we'll be like, let's have a meeting in the woods. And we're not just meeting. Suddenly we're doing forest bathing. And then suddenly Jen's, like, prompting questions. And we just, like, can't help ourselves.
I know.
It's really awesome.
I think that's kind of why the retreats happen. We just couldn't help ourselves.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Well, and we have an interesting story how we met.
Oh, my gosh. I know someone asked me the other day how we met.
That's yeah, so funny. Which is funny that we've never met because we know a lot of people in common. Mm-hmm. But my husband's cousin Mike, as we refer to him, one day, I think he emailed both of us and said, okay, I used to work with Jen and Kate lives in Madison. And I just feel like you two should know each other because I think you would just really like each other. And so we're like, okay, let's meet on Zoom. And I think within like 15 minutes, we're like, okay, we can do things together and we can be friends.
Yes.
So yes, that wasn't even a year ago.
No. Mm-mm. Seriously? Mm-hmm. Are you sure? Pandemic time?
March. I think it was last March. Because then we went to the woods.
Yeah.
And we went June, you know, to craft our experience. And then we went in July. As part of your summer experiences that you had created.
Yeah, I think you might be right.
And then we did our first retreat in...
Oh my gosh, that's crazy.
Okay, that's crazy. We can write that on your, like, celebration board.
Yeah.
Like, all the things we need to celebrate about ourselves. That's awesome.
So, yes, so thank you, Cousin Mike.
Thanks, Cousin Mike.
Former coworker Mike.
Yes.
And you know what? And that's also a really good lesson is, like, you never know who you're going to meet, how you're going to meet someone, and how they're going to impact your life.
Right. That's the whole idea of interconnectedness and that. Mm-hmm. Coming to notice those things finally. Yeah. Super cool.
Or allowing those experiences to happen and being open to them. Because either one of us could have been like, okay, thanks, Mike. I'll definitely reach out.
Yeah.
No, but both of us were curious enough and excited enough to to reach out to each other. So
I'm so glad we did.
Me too.
Yeah. So what do you think is the biggest takeaway from the retreats that our guests?
I think the biggest takeaways, and honestly, it was a realization I had just now or during this talk, was really how nature can give you those anchors to carry with you throughout your days.
Right.
So whether it be a smell or a sound or a feeling that you get when you're out in nature.
Yeah.
And then if you pair that with a question or pair that with some kind of curiosity about yourself, that can carry with you throughout your whole lifetime.
Right. Well, and then you can tap into it. Once you notice how to notice in these ways that we're cultivating on our retreats, you can be walking down a city block and maybe there's a similar tree and that's like, oh, and that prompts it. Or it could just be the way the wind blows across a field that brings you back to that spot. So you don't necessarily have to be in big nature.
No.
To make those little micro connections.
And you don't have to be in nature for long either. Like you said, like 5 minutes can make such a big impact.
Huge. Really huge. Yeah, I think too, like, what I hope is that people come away with a deeper sense of joy, you know, a bursting sense of joy and fulfillment. I think especially, well, I'm midlife. I won't talk about anybody else where they're at. But yeah, especially at this point in life too, when it's, and people, adults of all ages come on our walks and experiences and do life coaching and forest bathing. But it's just a chance, especially after these past 2 years, to kind of recalibrate, like, okay, where am I at? Who am I? Like, what am I taking away from this experience that has changed our lives so greatly, my life greatly? And how do I want to be moving forward?
How do I want to be moving forward?
Yeah, exactly.
Thanks, well, Jen. Thank you so much. Yes. I'm so excited. Please, please, please check out truenaturetrueself.com and check out what we have there because we want to be in the woods.
Yeah, and it's super fun. I mean, yeah, it's just a really great time and we had a blast and some really great openings with the retreat we did in October. So please come join us.
Yes.
Love to see you.
Thanks, Kate.
Thanks.